Welcome, Prime Minister Zenawi.
Thank you.
When the economic crisis broke, you were very concerned. You said Africa will probably suffer the most. 2 years down the line, you feel that Africa is actually benefiting from the changing world scenario economically. And one of the changes we see is that countries like India are perhaps taking more interest in Africa, and Ethiopia is very keen to build with growing economies like India. So do you actually feel that the economic shakedown that took place has actually benefited Ethiopia?
Well, the re-emergence of India and China and a few other countries has changed the economic geography of the world, and it has changed it for the better. As far as the countries of those peoples of those countries are concerned, and most importantly from our point of view, as far as Africa is concerned. My concern was that the economic crisis might dampen the growth of these emerging countries and therefore directly and indirectly affect Africa.
But you find that that hasn't really happened?
It has not really happened, and we're very relieved that it has not really happened.
But in fact, the reverse has taken place. Countries like India that were working with the US and with Europe are now finding those markets perhaps not as lucrative as they were in the past, and going off the beaten track, and they're coming to places like Ethiopia. And that's where you have set a target of $1 billion of trade by 2015. How do you plan to achieve that? Because setting targets is usually quite easy. That's on paper. But in practice, it needs a lot more groundwork and effort to achieve them. So what have you planned out for that?
We plan to encourage Indian private sector investment in Ethiopia. It's already significant. Well over $4 billion of investment from India.
In fact, India is the largest foreign investor in Ethiopia today.
It is. And we believe this will have the indirect impact of boosting trade between our two countries. We believe that our agricultural development strategy fits in well with the requirements of the Indian market. We'll be able to export agricultural products, particularly pulses, to India. And so this combination of Indian foreign direct investment in Ethiopia and the development strategy that we have charted for ourselves will combine, in my view, to not only achieve the target we have set for ourselves, but go beyond that.
Prime Minister Manmohan Singh visited Ethiopia recently. And in fact, that's the first time that an Indian Prime Minister visited your country. And you, after the visit, of course, said that you were very pleased with the outcome. What is it that pleased you?
Well,
Agreements or the way forward or the interaction that you had on a personal level with the Prime Minister?
It's all of the above. On a personal note, it's very gratifying to be able to welcome a leader of such a great country. Very well read, extremely modest, very supportive of Ethiopia's and Africa's agenda. So on a personal note, it was a very pleasant few days. At the African level, we were able to consolidate the emerging strategic partnership between India and Africa. It's always been there. India has always been a friend of Africa, and Africa has always been a friend of India. But the reemergence of India has created new opportunities that didn't exist before. And I think the summit allowed us to chart a new course that is consistent with the emerging realities. On the bilateral front, as you probably know, Ethiopia is in the front ranks of partnership with India in Africa. Indeed, we pride ourselves with having established such a close relationship with India that it could be a model for the overall Africa-India partnership. On all these fronts, bilateral and multilateral, we believe we have achieved all the targets that we set for ourselves. And therefore, on all fronts, the visit was a tremendous success.
You've also signed up some agreements. You are looking at a credit line. You're looking at investment on a highway. What is it that was really important for you to sign up?
The avoidance of double taxation was important because we felt that this could boost foreign direct investment from India to Ethiopia. The agreement on the credit line, which will be used to build a new railway line, is very important because infrastructure bottlenecks in Ethiopia and across the continent are among the most important impediments to development in our countries. And lastly, but in my view most importantly, we agreed on a number of human resource development and technology transfer arrangements. In the end, I believe development is about enhancing human capacities, and India has a comparative advantage in these areas that could be of enormous help to Africa and to Ethiopia in particular. We are already doing a lot in that area, but we have agreed to do a lot more, and that for me is very gratifying.
There's also the question of farming for Indians in Ethiopia, where you're giving out land to Indian farmers who wish to come here, corporates as well as individuals who wish to come here and set up large farms. This, of course, has also brought about a debate in your country about the issue of giving land to foreigners, especially in view of the fact that privatization of land in Ethiopia is also being debated. Currently, all the land is held by the government. Do you think that this would in some way dampen the initiative that you've taken of leasing land to farmers from India who can come here, develop the farming and sell the crops in an open market?
I think there is some misplaced fear of so-called land grab stoked by people who should know better. Of course, we are aware of the history of land grab in Africa. It happened at the end of the 19th century and early 20th century. The land grab in Zimbabwe, for example, resulted in more than 70% of arable land in Zimbabwe being owned by a few white farmers from Europe. Same applies to South Africa. Now, people who should know better about the circumstances of this land grab are now transposing this onto the rest of the continent in a completely different environment. In the case of Ethiopia, for example, as you rightly indicated, private land ownership is not allowed. All land is publicly owned. And therefore, the possibility of a land grab simply does not exist. Secondly, what we are doing is putting all unutilized land in this country. And we have a lot of unutilized land in the lowlands of Ethiopia. We have land scarcity in the highlands, where over 80% of the population lives. But we have abundant unutilized land in the lowlands. What we have done is to build infrastructure in those areas and therefore open up the area for investment, both by domestic and foreign private sector, on the basis of a clearly set out lease arrangement. Now that is a win-win arrangement. It is not a land grab. And therefore we are very comfortable with the fact that we have put in place all the necessary guidelines, environmental and otherwise, to make sure that everybody benefits from this exercise. And we welcome Indian private investment in agricultural development of our country. And it's not just Indians who are investing in Ethiopia in agriculture. There are people from the Middle East who are also investing in agriculture in Ethiopia. And so we believe the fear of foreigners grabbing our land is completely misplaced.
At the same time, Indians have suffered in the past in some countries in Africa where they've been asked to leave when a regime changes. In this case, there will be a concern that if your government is giving this land on long lease, which could be 50 years, subsequent governments may reverse the policy. Is there any risk of that?
I don't think there's going to be any risk of that for a number of reasons. First, these lease agreements that we are signing with Indian as well as other foreign companies are precisely designed to make sure that everybody benefits. Once people begin to see the results of the investments in terms of job creation, availability of foreign exchange, availability of various agricultural products in our markets and so on, they will see the benefits for themselves. And it would be completely rational for them to try to shoot themselves on the foot. And so the benefit of the investment will, in my view, be its ultimate protection. And secondly, we have a constitutional order here. And the constitution clearly states that you do not empower, you do not grab property from anybody. There is a rule of law here, and it is firmly entrenched in our system, and that provides additional, and in my view, adequate protection to all investments, including agricultural investments.
There is also a debate of privatization, I believe, in your country. Do you plan in the future at some time to privatize land holdings for your Ethiopian population?
We do not believe that would be a wise policy. But that would be for future generations to decide if they want to change this policy. In my view, land privatization would end up in concentration of land ownership in fewer and fewer hands. At the moment, all small-scale farmers in Ethiopia technically own their own land. They cannot sell it, but they can pass it on to the next generation by way of inheritance. They can rent it. So they have all the property rights that they need except the ability to buy and sell land. And that, in my view, provides more protection to the small-scale farmer from being dispossessed in one form or another. So my view is that this is the best policy for us here in Ethiopia. But as you rightly indicated, there are people who have different ideas. And if their ideas gain currency, then it would be possible to change that in the future.
You have in fact worked as a revolutionary in your younger days and then later been part of government for close to two decades now. How was this transition? Because very few people make a successful transition from a revolutionary to government, to a statesman. How did you find the transition from being a rebel to being in government and at the helm of affairs of your country? Was the transition easy?
No transition is easy, and this is as difficult as it gets. But I think I would characterize myself as a rebel with a cause, and the cause has remained the same, but the means of delivering on that cause have changed. There were times when carrying a gun and fighting the enemy was the only means of delivering on the cause. Now that is behind us. Now it's an issue of the boring nitty-gritty of building roads here, schools there, clinics here. Enticing some businessmen to build a textile factory here and so on.
And that's much more difficult than pointing a finger.
Absolutely.
And finding fault.
Absolutely. It's much more difficult, but at the same time much more rewarding, because this is about opening up possibilities for life, not ending life for the sake of some cause.
But you do come under a lot of criticism. Does that hurt? Because some of it could be quite unfair. At least from your point of view, you will see the criticism as being rather unfair. So does that hurt you?
No, it doesn't. As the Americans would say, if you don't like the heat, don't get into the kitchen.
But at the same time, does that come across sometimes to you as something that is annoying?
Not really.
Or frustrating, should I say?
Not really, because I draw satisfaction from the fact that I have done my level best to achieve my cause, and that the results are there for me and others to see. That is my source of satisfaction. I completely understand that others might have a completely different perspective. And that's perfectly legitimate, so long as they do it in a peaceful manner. They have every right to evaluate my performance more critically than I would evaluate myself.
You, in fact, gave up medicine. You were studying medicine to go into politics. And you went back to study again, formal education, much later. Why did you think the need to get that formal education?
I think generally one stops learning when one dies. And so I have tried to learn every day. And I felt I needed support from formal education to enhance my capacity to learn on a daily basis. And I wanted to adjust the subjects that I wanted to learn in a manner that would make some contribution to what I'm doing on a daily basis. So I wanted to learn something about management and something about economics, because these two subjects were very important in what I do on a daily basis. So I took some formal education in both subjects, and that, in my view, has enhanced my capacity to learn on my own.
You're very passionate about education, and over the years you've tried to build the education system in Ethiopia. In fact, one of the areas where Indians were involved a great deal in the past was education. You had many Indian teachers here. Looking into the future, do you see India as also being a part of what you are now looking at as better quality and even a higher quantity of universities and primary schools in the country?
Absolutely. As you rightly indicated, Indians have been involved from the very beginning in the education sector in Ethiopia. You're looking at one of those products of Indian teachers in Ethiopia. Indian teachers are also involved now in a very big way. We have Indian teachers here. We have Indian universities providing long distance education to Ethiopians. IIT Delhi, for example, is providing master's courses in various engineering fields through video conferencing facilities. Your professors do the lecturing from Delhi. Our students attend these classes on video conferences. From time to time, these Indian professors come here to provide some backup. So we are using new technology and we are expanding the scope and cooperation in education. India is better placed than most to help Ethiopia and I think Africa in general in expanding this scope of the capacity of our human resources.
You wrote Dead End, New Beginning in 2006. Do you see that as being what your country goes through? Quite often, you reach the end of the road and then you restart. Are you at the threshold now of breaking through and not looking back? Because we do see a lot of development in Ethiopia, lots of housing, infrastructure. So do you feel now you've gained the critical mass to move ahead?
I think we now have the momentum. We have had more than 7 years of double-digit growth continuously. We believe we can sustain that. Ethiopians are now talking of the Ethiopian Renaissance as part of the African Renaissance. We have made some headway, perhaps more so than some other African countries. But I believe if we manage our affairs properly, not only Ethiopia, but Africa as a whole are likely to be growth poles, the new growth pole. As I was saying in one of the G20 meetings, most people in the world would have discounted India as a new growth pole in the early 1980s. Some economists had some rather insulting characterization of Indian growth rates. Now, from the beginning of the 90s, India has all of a sudden sprinted. And the rest, as I say, is history.
That's interesting you point that out. So do you see perhaps some countries, perhaps even your country, suffering a perception problem where the world perceives the country in a stereotype way, and that actually reality is moving a lot faster? And this is one of the challenges you have in this globalized world where the information war is being fought out.
Absolutely, absolutely. And I draw encouragement and lessons from the fact that India has crashed the so-called Hindustan rate of growth through very fast growth over two decades. But it took a lot of doing to erase that image. And it will do a lot of doing to erase the image of Africa as a hopeless continent and Ethiopia as part of that picture of hopeless continent.
You've said some time ago that this will be your last term as Prime Minister and you would not stand for elections for the next term. For a person who's been very active for decades and at the helm of affairs, what is it that you plan to do in the future? After you give up the current role of Prime Minister?
Take a bit of rest. I think I deserve to take a bit of rest.
Would that be easy for a person who works all the time and who's physically and mentally absolutely on the ball?
Like all transitions, it might have its challenges, but I think it will also have its rewards. I'll be able to reflect on the past few decades. Perhaps write some things which could be of some interest and some value for future generations of Ethiopians. Get out of the hurly-burly of daily political activity and see how these things look when you have the time to reflect on them.
So when you look back at your years, what is it that really stretched you and you felt that it was very challenging? Was it the time that you had to clamp down and over 100 civilians lost their lives? Or was it the war that you had to go through? Or was it was the Nile water issue the most challenging that you've had to face?
Well, all of those were very challenging. 17 years of armed struggle against a very well entrenched regime could not but be a challenge. The border war we had with Eritrea was a challenge. The disturbances we had in 2005 after the elections was a heart-rending challenge. And there were many other challenging periods. But for me, the most important challenge has been one that is not noticed by everybody, not noticed by anybody indeed, which is the internal party debate on how to move forward and where to move, which was conducted some 10 years ago.
So you're not talking about the time after the war with Eritrea where you had the internal party challenge?
That is immediately after the end of the war with Eritrea. We had a very challenging situation within the party. The party was almost was on the verge of disintegration. In the end, we scraped through. And as they say, the darkest moment in the night is just before dawn. And a few years later, 1 or 2 years later, we began this cycle of double-digit growth rates. So for me, it was this dark moment just before dawn that was the most challenging.
And it's not the case now?
It is not the case now.
In your days left as Prime Minister, what are the targets that you have set yourself? What is it that you really want to achieve?
The most important thing that I want to achieve is, again, expand the capacity of our youth in terms of technology, skills. We have a program to expand tertiary education, university education. Our targets are 70% of our university students should be in science and engineering. My target is to have all high school graduates who do not go to university access that they should have access to some form of technical and vocational training so that they are skilled and well equipped to fend for themselves, that we have quality, universal primary education. This is the key challenge. The next challenge is infrastructure. Develop our infrastructure, telecommunications, power, roads, railway systems. And lastly, to defeat hunger in the country through improved production of agriculture and overall economic growth. This will be my targets if I live at a time when Ethiopia will no longer need any emergency assistance, any food assistance. That will have been an achievement for a lifetime.
You have been president of the country in the past. Are you looking at the presidency after this?
No, I don't want to have any government positions.